Well, good morning. Those of you watching, wherever you are, whatever time of the day, night, evening it is, however you're watching, we welcome you to World Overcomers Church, soon to be Encounter Church. I'm standing here today in front of Holy Communion, the Lord's Supper. And I was telling the congregation earlier that I just sense such an unusual reverence for the Lord. Now, I do reverence the Lord throughout my day, throughout my life, but today especially, an unusual reverence for the things of God. Those of you watching, if you have your Bibles or iPhones, iPads, if you want to take them out and follow us, please do. Those of you here in church, you know what to do. Today I share with you seven blessings through the blood. Seven blessings through the blood. Of course, we're talking about the blood of Jesus. Now, on Wednesday nights, we've been having blowouts in the Spirit. Blowouts in the Spirit. Wednesday night, I don't know, it may be one of America's best-kept secrets. And on Wednesdays, we've been trying to share about the seven reasons why you should speak in tongues. We haven't gotten to it yet because the Holy Spirit has been demonstrating the seven reasons. Well, today I share with you seven blessings that can only come through the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, it's interesting in Leviticus chapter 14, verse number 7, how God instructed Moses that the priest was to sprinkle a leper seven times with the blood of a bird, and then the leper would be cleansed. We see here, and he shall sprinkle it seven times on him who is to be cleansed from the leprosy, and shall pronounce him clean, and shall let the living bird loose in the open field. We see here several things. That blood was sprinkled how many times?
Seven
times. Notice here, the individual was not cleansed of leprosy until first the blood was applied. Are you with me? You shall sprinkle it seven times on him who is to be cleansed, who is to be cleansed from his leprosy, and then pronounce him clean. As this blood was sprinkled of an animal, or if you would, a bird, there's something spiritually symbolic about the number seven. And seven times, Moses was instructed by God to do something very vital. God will always give us an instruction before he can entrust us with what it is he wants us to do. See, many times we just want to do it. Let's get the show on the road. But we do not follow the instructions. This is why in football, they have camp in the summer to get ready for the fall and winter. This is why in baseball, they have spring training in February for games that officially start in April. There's preparation in life for everything. A mother prepares herself. You just don't go, ladies, wouldn't you just love to come home? Or men, wouldn't you love to just come home and snap your fingers and dinner's on the table? If you're going to cook, it requires preparation. We all want to eat and enjoy. Or sometimes we even complain about the food. Sometimes even the spiritual food. Or we're not happy with the waiter or the preacher. But not everybody wants to jump in the kitchen and cook the food. Not everybody's willing to get up and tell people, thus saith the Lord. So we notice here God always gives an instruction before he can pour out a blessing. A manual, directions, call it what you will. So we see here that the blood was sprinkled seven times in order for that leper to be cleansed. And then Moses was to pronounce a blessing. Let's go back to leprosy. The Bible clearly indicates that you and I, before we were saved, were spiritual lepers. Leprosy represents something that cannot be healed barring a miracle. Leprosy cannot be dealt with, as you can see, unless blood is applied. Before you knew Jesus as your Savior, you were a spiritual leper, and the blood of Jesus came upon you, sprinkled upon you, and it cleansed you from all unrighteousness. But notice something else here, very interesting. Very interesting. And you shall pronounce him clean. Now it's very important that you get this word here, pronounce. We in America today, in our church currently, and in many churches that believe the Gospels, the Gospel, we don't necessarily say, I pronounce the blood of Jesus. We do. We say that sometimes. I do sometimes. But we have a more of an in-house saying, or more of a 20th, 21st century saying, we call it pleading the blood. Now, this is very important for you to know, because some of your friends, some Christian folk today are preaching that there's no reason to plead the blood. There's no reason to call upon the blood, because everything is okay after you were born again. I can tell you, for me, 41 almost years in ministry, I plead the blood every day. Moses pronounced the blood over the people. And if Moses can pronounce the blood over people under an old covenant, and that's the blood of a bird, Hebrews says, I'm going to give you a better covenant with better promises. If Moses can declare the blood seven times over a physical ailment of the blood of a bird, how much all the more today can we announce and pronounce not the blood of a bird, but the blood of Jesus, not just over a leper, but over the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And you shall sprinkle it, an instruction, a distinct instruction. Last week we spoke about Peter catching 153 fish. What is it about a certain number that God throws out? Why three, Father, Son, Holy Spirit? Why five, grace? Why six, the number of man? Why seven, perfection? Eight, new beginnings? And it goes on and on. 12, disciples, 40 days in the wilderness, 50, Pentecost, 70 other disciples after the 12, 120 in the upper room, 300 Gideons. Oh, and it goes on. 3,000 that got saved in Acts chapter 2. 144,000 in the book of Revelation to preach the gospel. God is very precise. Today, we're talking about seven blessings through the blood of Jesus. So we see here that Moses was instructed. Today, I've been instructed. Not everybody receives my instructions. Guess what? Not everybody received Jesus' instructions. And who am I to think myself any better than him? Does it ever hurt me? Oh my God, the sting. And let me say something about stings. You never get used to them. Neither did Jesus. Neither does Jesus to this day. He takes blows left and right while he's interceding for us. And while sometimes poor choices are made, he's still taking blows for us. That's why Paul said in Galatians 4:19, he says, as a father, metaphorically, as a father, I travail for you till Christ be formed in you. What he was saying is, I pray for you more than you pray for you. I pray for your son more than you pray for your son. That's what Paul was saying. I pray for your daughter more than you do. I have more sleepless nights over you than you do for you. That's what Paul was saying. That's a father. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 4:15, you can have 10,000 teachers, but not many fathers. I'm all for teachers and I'm all for teaching. But I think sometimes the more teachings that we hear from more people sometimes, and we cross-pollinate. You know, they call a dog a mutt for a reason. God's looking for spiritual pedigrees where they can together hear the same thing. I'm not saying that you should not listen to somebody else, but honey, you ought to think twice and check their fruits. Check their fruits. In 10 years, are they still around? In 15 years, are they still preaching the cross and the blood of Jesus? So today we have to understand that God gives instructions. And not everybody enjoys those instructions. But we'll see here one more time. Sprinkle it 7 times on him or her or them who is to be cleansed from leprosy. Say, that's me. And then declare or pronounce or plead him clean. Why? How? Through the blood. Say, through the blood. All right. So we see 7 times here, Moses had an instruction to sprinkle the blood. At Calvary, Jesus' blood was shed 7 times at Calvary. Now remember the words of the Lord with Moses in Leviticus 14:7. At Calvary, Jesus' blood was shed, not 6, not 8, but 7 times. Number 1, the whipping on his back. Number 2, the crown of thorns. Number 3, the piercing in his side. Number 4, his right hand. Number 5, his left hand. Number 6, his right foot. Number 7, his left foot. Jesus' blood was shed from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet. And his blood was shed 7 times, just like the leper we just read about, for the leper to be cleansed. Well, Jesus' blood was shed 7 times from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet, so that you can be made clean, whole, victorious, righteous, the head, not the tail, above, not beneath, so that you can do all things through Christ. The reason why his blood was shed 7 times from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet, so that from the soles of your feet to the crown of your head, or from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, you can be made whole and complete. Hallelujah. 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 7 times the sprinkling of the blood of a bird. 7 times shed on the cross. On the cross, while Jesus was dying, he had 7 sayings. Many times around Easter time or Good Friday, sometimes on Good Friday, I ask 7 different people to share one of those 7 sayings. What Jesus said on the cross, "It is finished. I thirst. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. My God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And so on. So 7 times Moses sprinkled blood of an animal on the people. 7 times Jesus was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. And then 7 times he spoke on the cross. There's something that God has to say when he's getting particular about something, about a subject, what this number represents, what this action symbolizes. So all that being said, today I want to share with you, in addition, 7 promises through the blood, and they're all found in the same passage in Ephesians chapter 1, and we're going to read them all, and then we'll go back to them. So in Ephesians chapter 1, starting with verse number 7, 7 promises through the blood. Here we go. "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace." Verse 8. "Which he made to abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence." And verse number 9. "Having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself." Now, what I just gave you here in Ephesians 1, 7 through 9, are 7 blessings through the blood. Now, if you did not get them all in this short time, that's okay. Did not expect you to, because we did it quickly. But if you did get them, power to you. But you're all going to get it now, so power to you all. Verse number 7, number 1. "In him we have redemption." Number 1, redemption. Somebody say out loud, number 1, redemption. "When he shed his blood for us, he redeemed you." I'll say it again. When he shed his blood for you and for me, he completely set you free. He redeemed you. He freed you. Get ready to shout on this one. The blame that belonged to you, he removed it and he put it on himself. He who knew no sin, he became sin. Number 1, the blood has redeemed you. It's released you from carrying the shame, the guilt, and the blame. The blood has reconciled you. In other words, under this word, redemption, he has, by faith, positionally, he has restored you in every area known to mankind. If we stopped in number 1, if we stopped in number 1, it would be more than enough. He redeemed you. Shout, "I'm redeemed." Took the blame, put it on himself. Perfect, sinless Lamb of God. Reconciled us. By faith, restored us. Which means there's healing. Which means there's peace. Which means there's no double-mindedness. There's no division. When you understand the power of the blood of Jesus. Today I submit to you, when the devil comes and attacks, and if you give in to the attack, if you give in to the lie, if you give in to the vain imagination, I submit to you, the reason is there needs to be more proclamation of the blood of Jesus Christ. If you're having a problem in your mind where you're confused, plead the blood over your mind. If you're sick in body, plead the blood over, declare the blood. By his stripes, I am healed. But I don't feel healed. I don't feel healed. My back's still hurting. My neck's still hurting. My ankle's still hurting. I did not ask you to ask your body how your body feels. I'm telling you to proclaim and declare and plead, not the blood of an animal, but the blood of Jesus. The blood. Many times I should be dead, but the blood. Many times I should have died of a broken heart, but the blood. Many times my life, my children, my church, my family, my church family should have been dismantled. Should have been dismantled, but the blood. And we're to call upon it. The precious blood. The precious blood. The precious blood. You start proclaiming that blood, and you'll get what we mean. You start claiming that blood, and there'll be complete victory. There'll be complete unity. You elders, you department heads, you ministers, you pastors, you congregation, when you start pleading the blood in areas of your life, when you're under attack, I promise you, after that attack comes, it will not stay, it will not stick, you will not be double-minded, you will not be dysfunctional, you will not be confused, but you gotta call the blood! We call all right. We call all right. We release all right. But we need to release the blood. That's just number one. I think we ought to give God praise already. Hallelujah. Number two, the forgiveness of sins. When you call upon the blood, he'll cleanse you of all unrighteousness. Now you say, but I've already been redeemed. Yeah? Yeah, but I still have to pick up my cross every day. I still have to die to self every day. Number two, he'll forgive you ongoing. His blood will never lose its power. Number three, notice here, it doesn't just say that he'll give you grace through his blood, but there are riches to his grace. An abundance of grace through the blood. A lot of people today are preaching grace, but a lot of people are leaving out the blood. There'd be no grace without the blood. Grace, his ability to do in you what you cannot do for yourself. His grace, amazing grace. All through the blood. So number one, we have redemption. Number two, the forgiveness of sin. Number three, the abundance or the riches of his grace. Verse number eight, and we'll look at number four and five. Which he made to abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence. Here in verse eight, we have number four and number five. Wisdom and prudence. Can you all say that together?
Wisdom
When you declare the blood, when you call upon the blood, he will give you wisdom. Wisdom is to have accurate insight. Accurate insight. This is why the Bible says, before partaking of Holy Communion, the Lord's Supper, it says, let a man or woman examine themselves. It does not say examine the pastor or the team or the church or the husband or the wife or the son or the daughter or your job. It says let him or her examine himself. Many Christians are so busy examining other ministries, other people, that they themselves are falling by the wayside. That's why we need the hammer to break the rocks in pieces, the axe to get to the root. Number four, he will give you accurate insight. What is wisdom? Oh, there's many definitions of wisdom. I'm sure you can come up with a good few ones. But wisdom is accurate insight, and it's the ability to do things and say things in a timely manner. Proverbs says, like apples of silver in settings of gold is a true word spoken. In other words, there's a time and a season to say the right thing at the right time. In fact, we should always say the right thing at the right time. But sometimes we say the wrong thing. Or sometimes we say the right thing at the wrong time. Now think about this, and you may chuckle, and that's okay, but I'm very serious. Imagine a woman who's labored for 9 months, opens herself up literally, tears, just calling it like it is, if be, and the husband or her friends and family or church folk come and look and say, oh, I was hoping it would be a girl. Oh, I was hoping it would be a boy. There's a saying among women who give birth, and we don't claim this, ladies. It's called postpartum blues. I know many ladies. I dealt with one lady years ago in another church who wound up in a mental institution with postpartum blues. Now, really, it was deeper than that. She took on a spirit. Folks, let me tell you something. One of the quickest ways to impart an evil spirit, not necessarily into somebody because you're covered with the blood, but onto somebody. How many know you can impart an evil spirit on somebody? That's why the Bible says no weapon formed against you shall prosper. That's why you need to claim that. That's why I pray the Lord's Prayer every day. Lead us not into temptation and deliver me from evil. No devil can come in me, but he sure can try to attack my outside. So when you have wisdom, you're applying facts. If you're going to start a business, you just don't start a business somewhere. You survey the area. Is there a need for this? Is there a desire for something like this? How many know in February is not the time to open up an ice cube store in Chicago? Thank God for ice cubes. I've been using a lot this summer. How about you? But in the middle of February, if all you're going to do is sell ice, you're going to be sitting on your ice for a while. Ice, sitting on ice. That's why we have to get off of our ice and speak words of time. Preachers, when they get done preaching, they love to run away from people. I don't blame them. People say the stupidest things, and children run up to you. And they tell you how they're your heroes. They're your superheroes. When I say people saying stupid things, I'm not talking about you. Tell your neighbor and say, I know he's not talking about me. Go, you, that's all right, go ahead. The blood's here today, it's cool. But wisdom says protect the anointing. Wisdom says protect each other. Wisdom is taking the facts that you have, but I got facts! Wisdom says let's take the facts and ask God for discernment on how and when and if. That's why the Bible says there's safety in the multitude of wise counsel. There ain't safety in the multitude of hurt sheep hurting sheep. There's not safety in the multitude of confused sheep. Confused. I'm talking to somebody right now. I'm under the blood this morning. I'm covered by the blood. I can say whatever I want. I said his word's a hammer. His hammer is going to hit sometimes. If you're going to leave this place with 100-fold, honey, you're going to get it. So we see here that number four, God will give you wisdom. Lord, I call the blood of Jesus. Give me wisdom, Lord. How many know your heart can be right, but your head a little off? I know a lot of sincere people that really make sincere mistakes and really sincerely hurt people. They didn't sincerely mean to hurt them, they just did, by not applying wisdom. In your everyday life, wisdom. Pleading the blood over your family. I plead it over you. Wisdom. So the blood releases the wisdom of God. Just the way the blood releases the grace of God. Are you with me? Yes. Number five, prudence. Now that's a lot like wisdom. Prudence is to be skilled with good judgment and understanding. Folks, I'm telling you what. You apply what I'm saying through the blood, you'll never lose your job. Unless they just totally close up. But let me tell you, if they do, if you apply this, that next position somewhere else, you'll be one of the first hired. Some people don't want to hire people because they don't use wisdom. I don't want to pay somebody in whom their work I have to redo their work. Would you want to be like that? Shoot. I don't want some lady cleaning my house to only have to clean it again. Miles will do it myself. If that be the case. Prudence. Through the blood. Number five. Skilled with good judgment and understanding. Like wisdom. Accurate insight, the ability to use facts, act wise and timely. Prudence is almost the same. They're like kissing cousins. Skilled with good judgment and understanding. Two more. You ready for two more? Six and seven, verse number nine. Having then made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself. Number six, the blood of Jesus will cause you to know the mysteries of his will. I call that divine revelation. Now remember, in the parable of the sower, everybody heard it. Is everybody hearing today? Yes. Just like the parable of the sower, they all heard it, but they did not all get it. Did you know that today in America, and this is pretty exciting, at least momentarily, today in America, upon multiple surveys, 70% of Americans claim to be believers in Christ. 70% of Americans, now you wish it was 90, 99, 100, but for the world we live in, 70% claim to be believers. Praise the Lord. But here's the negative. Out of the 70% of Americans who claim to be believers, Because you're one of those 70%. You're a believer, right? Yeah? If you're not, the blood will cleanse you. So we're part of that 70%. While 70% of America claims to be believers, here's my question, and I do not know the answer. How many percent of those 70 who claim to be believers, look at me please, how many of them are followers? The devils believe and they tremble. If being a believer in itself was enough, hell would be empty. Even the devils believe. The question is, are we followers? When it's time to pray, are we followers? When it's time to give, time to serve, are we followers? Everybody just about claims to believe. But a believer never changed anybody. Jesus said to his disciples, put down your nets. And he did not say, believe me. He said, follow me. Of course we have to be believers. But a believer will never change anybody or anything. A believer will never in itself make an impact upon your life. It's only a follower. That's why followers sometimes do things a little different. People don't always understand followers. In fact, some people may, even in the church, get offended if somebody's truly following. Because people are used to being assembled with believers, but they're not used to being filled with followers. This is why pastors, churches will tell you 20% of the people do 80% of the work. It's the truth. This is why there are less tithers than more. Why? Everybody believes. You all believe in tithing? Sure you do. You all believe in serving? But why aren't you serving? You know, many times we think in our flesh we're getting away with something. Every day has its judgment. But sometimes the greatest judgment will come on Judgment Day. And I want to, without bringing condemnation, challenge you this morning to work the works of Him who sent you while it's day. I promise you, if you would start from this day on taking the focus off of you and your needs and start focusing on somebody or something else and their needs, I promise you, I swear to you, by the authority of God's word, He said, if you're trying to save your life, you're going to lose it. But if you're willing to lose it, you will find it. He said, if you seek first the kingdom of God, not your kingdom, and His righteousness, not yours, all these things will be added unto you, unto me. Folks, this is a message for all of us today, including yours truly. Number six, He will reveal to you mysteries, divine revelation. The reason why 20% of the people do 80% of the work, the reason why most don't serve in church, most after 3 years still haven't given first fruits, and the list can go on, still see a need in the nursery and still don't care, is because they're lacking the mysteries of His will. The mysteries of His will are what Isaiah prophesied. those hidden riches in dark places, where you see dark and empty and not in need, God sees, come unto me and let's get this job done. It takes the blood of Jesus to take information. Hear me, please. Please. It takes the blood of Jesus to take information and turn it into revelation.
Yes.
After 21 years of preaching here, almost 41 overall, I've come out in this house anointed every service, have never backed down nor compromised. But there's always one. The Bible says a little fox spoils the whole vine. Little leaven leavens the whole lump. We don't give up on that person. I'm talking everywhere. Somebody shout everywhere.
Everywhere.
I'm not saying this to you, but I will say it about your job. There's always a jerk on the job. Question is, who is it? Question is, who is it, Chet? But the blood, when declared, will reveal mysteries that your mind will not be boggled with and be analytical with and trying to figure it out. The blood sometimes will cause you to drink it and not think it. The blood. That's why Paul said in 1 Corinthians 1:10, I plead, I beg you, in the name of Jesus, I plead the blood. Speak the same thing, church. Say the same thing, church. And there'll be no division among you. Which means if there's no division among you, there's unity. And Psalm 133 says unity will cause an explosion. But I will continue to receive letters from people, phone calls, messages, speaking contrary to what I shared today. You say impossible? It may be you that I'm talking about. Now, folks, listen. God's given me patience. Here's what God spoke to me the other day. He said, son, you're not running out of patience. Hear me very carefully. Because I have to evaluate my life for me. Paul said, lest I become a castaway. Here's what the Lord said. He said, son, you're not running out of patience. Look at me. He said, son, you're not running out of patience. What do you tell me, Pastor Derek?
You're running out of time.
I'm running out of time. I'm not running out. Listen, you don't last 41 years in ministry. 1,800 quit every month, 4,500 churches every year, not here. I'm not running out of patience. I'm running out of time. And so are you. But the Bible says, occupy till I come. The psalmist said what, Pastor Derek? Teach.
Teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom.
That's why Paul said in 1 Corinthians 3:1-3, he said to the church, I can't believe you. After all I've shared with you and imparted to you and laid down my life, you still act like babies. Folks, pardon me today. Don't forgive me, but pardon me. Whenever I talk about the blood, it's a serious thing. This is life and death issue here, folks. That's why it's hard for me to talk about any other subject today because of the blood. He said some have become weak and sick and dropped dead before their times because of judgmentalism. I'm not here to be critical. You guys have a hard week. I want you to enjoy this week. But I can't comfort you with mere words, but with the truth. So he said, verse 9, when you plead the blood, I'll reveal to you mysteries. In other words, you'll see things that others do not. And you'll be in the flow. I said you'll be in the flow. That doesn't mean you never have questions. I said you'll be in the flow. You'll hold up the woman of God's arms, not put them down. You'll rejoice whether that woman gives birth to a boy or to a girl. You'll rejoice. You'll say, wow, you suffered and you bled for all of these hours, and congratulations. Yeah. Finally, Shamando Diosando, number 7. Number 6, he revealed mysteries. Remember, that's his revelation. Divine revelation is number 6. If you don't call upon the blood, hear me. If you do not call upon the blood, you are like the parable of the sower. You get excited, but you leave empty. But if you apply the blood, you'll leave with the goods. Number 7, verse number 9, the knowledge of his will. In other words, the pleading of the blood of Jesus will allow you to discover God's plan for your life. And God's plan is not for you to be dysfunctional. Your husband may be, but it doesn't mean you should be. Your child may be, your co-worker may be, your wife may be, but it does not mean you should be. You need to be functional so that they can have an example of who a true Christian is. Dysfunctional people blame other people. Dysfunctional people blame other people, and they're quick to tell you what's wrong with you and your ministry or your job. Functional people look at themselves and say, what am I doing wrong? I'm just going to tell you right now, I'm going to cast my bread upon the waters. I need some fresh intercessors. I'm not just talking about people that will pity pat pray for me every now and then. Thank God for you. I need heavy-duty intercessors. If we're going to be like that first century church and be the kingdom, then I need some people to rise up and say, I'm going to pray for you, man of God, according to the word of God, like I've never prayed for you, because I'm prudent enough, I have revelation enough through the blood, knowing that the more I pray for you, the greater my breakthrough. Yeah. Oh, Taki. Number 7, you'll know his will. You won't have to have Prophet Jones or Bones or Schmones to come in and prophesy over you. Nor will you take access to freely decide what you're going to do with the rest of your life. That's illegitimacy. That's no different than your baby telling you what to do. Crawling away. The blood will put you in the perfect will of God. Not in the will of man, not in the will of a church, not in the will of an apostle, but in the will of God. And when you're in the will of God, you'll be in alignment with that church. 7 promises through the blood. Discovering God's plan for your life. That's what the blood does, knowing his will. Number 1, I'm going to call them out and then you say them out loud. Number 1, redemption. Yes. Forgiveness. Yes. Riches of his grace. Riches of his grace. Wisdom.
Wisdom.
Prudence.
Prudence.
Mysteries.
Mysteries.
That is divine revelation. And finally, number 7, knowing his will. Okay? Leviticus, Moses, 7 times. Received an instruction, the leper was healed. 7 times Jesus shed his blood on the cross. 7 times he received the bruising at the cross for us. 7 times he made a proclamation on the cross. And 7 times in Ephesians 1:7-9 does he give you 7 promises. And really, if you just looked at redemption alone, there's a lot more. How many know what I'm saying? Okay, now watch this as we prepare to close. Because everything you've heard to this point has just been my introduction. Watch this very carefully. Say, Lord, I need the blood applied to my life every day. Folks, I'm serious. Thank God for pastors and elders and oil. Thank God for all of that. Thank God for counsel. But the blood is so near. And in Romans 3, it says you can have faith in the blood. Now watch this. As I'm continuing to be led by the Lord, get ready to scream or shout. Exodus 24, starting at verse number 6. Watch this. Exodus 24, verse 6. And Moses took half of the blood and put it in basins. And half of the blood he sprinkled on the altar. Now, folks, this is, again, Moses receiving an instruction. So Moses took the blood now of an ox. And he took the blood and he put it in multiple basins. Now watch this. He took half of the blood and he sprinkled it on the altar. Look at me, please. It's time that you take your mind, your heart, your body, your children, your family, your emotions, and put them on the altar. And when you put your life, like Isaac, on the altar, not only put yourself there, but call upon the blood of Jesus to keep you there on the altar. The blood was put on the altar. On the altar. There are things that you need to put on the altar. There are family members that are not with you today. You need to put them on the altar. And when you put them on the altar, keep them there. How do you keep them there? Declaring the blood of Jesus. I have a daughter who's 36. She'll be 37 in July. Not seen her in years. I have a 4-year-old grandson I've never met. Say, oh, I feel so sorry for you. I'm really going to start praying for you now. Honey, if you're going to start praying for me now for that, it's too late. I don't need prayer for things that I've overcome. I need prayer from where I'm going. I need prayer for where I'm leading you. Now, do I love my daughter? Do I love my grandson? Of course I do. But guess what? My Rebecca is on the altar. My grandboy, my grandson, little brown hair, brown eyes, never met him. He's on the altar. Yeah. But what if they get away? What if you're not there, preacher? It's okay. They're covered by the blood. Now watch this. Basins. God always has a plan. The blood first on the altar. Now look at verse number 7, please. Then he took the book of the covenant. Ah. You take this covenant serious? It's a covenant. It's Old Testament, but it's covenant. It's Ten Commandments, but it's covenant. It's the Pentateuch. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. But it's a covenant. Say, it's a covenant. Folks, this is why I take this thing serious. He took the blood of the covenant. I'm sorry, he took the book of the covenant and read in the hearing of the people. Is that what we're doing this morning? The people here today? Yep. And he said, quote, all that the Lord has said, we will do. How many believe all that the Lord has said, we will do? Now watch this, verse number 8, because there's another basin. Look at verse number 8. Then Moses took the blood, sprinkled it, or declared it, or was pleading it on the people, and said, "This is the blood of the covenant which the Lord has made to you according to all his words." I submit to you, the blood was in two basins. Moses took the blood and he put it on the altar. When my children have issues, I put them on the altar and I put them on the blood. I put the blood of Jesus over them. When I'm having issues with you, or I should say, you having issues with me, I put you on the altar and I sprinkle the blood, and that's all I can do. And if I leave worried, if I leave discouraged, then I need to go back to the altar and reapply the blood. And he took the blood of the covenant and he sprinkled it on the people. The blood on the leper, the blood on the cross over your life, but now the blood on the altar and the blood on your life. Now watch this. When you go to God's altar and the blood is already on it, and now the blood's been applied to your life, you take the blood of Jesus on your life and the blood that's on the altar, and when the blood of Jesus on you reaches the blood of Jesus on the altar, bam! Yeah. One more verse. Hebrews. Because let's get into the new covenant here. Hebrews 12 and verse 24. The author of Hebrews speaks about a better covenant, better promises. Watch this. To Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant. Do we just speak about an old covenant and the blood? Yes. Now Jesus, say Jesus.
Jesus.
The go-between, the mediator of a new covenant. Folks, today I'm telling you, there's an old covenant that's still alive, covered with the blood. And there's a new and better covenant covered with the blood. You cannot lose. Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and the blood of sprinkling. Watch this. That speaks better things than that of Abel. Which means, if Moses under the old, hear me, if Moses under the old experienced victory in the blood of an animal, how much all the more can you experience the power of the blood through the sacrificed lamb?
Hallelujah.
And where does it start for you? At the cross. Where does it start for you? Through his blood. Now follow me carefully. Follow me. Just the way they had to follow Moses with instructions and they got their victory. Follow me to the end. Stay with me to the end. Watch this now. Keep that verse right there. Does it all sound so good so far? Yes or no? Yes or no? So today, we can speak the blood. Today, we can. I want you to scream, I plead the blood.
I plead the blood.
Come on, one more time.
I plead the blood.
You need to get used to that. Over your mind.
Yeah.
Over me.
Yeah.
Over this church.
Yeah.
Over each other.
Yeah.
Over America.
Yeah.
Over your children's school.
Yes.
Over your heart.
Yes.
Plead the blood.
Yes.
You don't have to sprinkle it anymore. You can just call upon the blood.
Amen.
Now watch this verse. Watch this verse. Watch this verse. Okay. The sprinkling of the blood that speaks better things than that of Abel. Huh. That of Abel. Where does Abel come in on the blood of Jesus? I thought that was Moses, okay. Jesus, of course. Abel. Talking about a new covenant. Talking about pleading the blood. Talking about seven victorious promises. What does Abel have to do with today? Abel had a brother named Cain. And Cain killed Abel. All over. And look at me dead in the eyes, I dare you. Show me the eye of the tiger. The kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. The wicked pursue when no one's around, but the righteous are bold as lions. Have that eye of the tiger. Jesus. The word of the Lord includes Abel regarding the blood, because Abel's blood was innocent. The account of the first murder in the Bible was a brother killing a brother. And that's why today in the church, the devil wants brothers to kill brothers, sisters to kill sisters. But hear me carefully, every eye on me, please. Why would Abel be so privileged to be mentioned in this message today on sevens? Where does Abel come in? Because his brother killed him. Look at me. Over a sacrificial offering called first fruits. For some of you, that was information. And I have to accept that. To others of you, it was information, a revelation. Be it unto you today which you want to leave with. I'll repeat it again because faith comes by hearing. First fruits will not only open the door to the blood of Jesus being activated in ways you've never seen before. The blood will cleanse you. But today, when I practice those seven principles, but now, when I give first fruits offerings, not just tithe, we're tying this all in together, as you can see, by the leading of the Holy Spirit. Because where your treasure is, your heart is. Or else we're back to the 20% doing 80%. Say no more of that junk. Say it. Yeah, tell your neighbor, no more of that junk. Come on, don't just say it. Look at them and say it like you believe it. One of these days I'm going to hang out with you and you're going to be desperate and telling me a story. And I'm going to look at you and say, and you're going to say, you're a clown. Folks, there's passion in this house today. People used to call me passion, not pastor, passion. It ain't leaving. It's only just begun. Abel is mentioned. That's how much God thinks of first fruits. Because when I give my first fruit, it activates the blood of Jesus. So today, I've never gotten this direct. I'm going to ask you. The tithe is a gimme, not give me. Not give me, it's a gimme. Your regular offering, that brings you your regular harvest. But today I'm going to ask you to write a first fruit check every month, whatever God puts on your heart, not what I tell you to do. I'm not one to lift your hand, who's going to do this? I'm not one to do that. I'm not against it. I'm just going to be blunt with you. I'm not for it. I'm not against it. I'm just not for it. But I'm asking for people every month. We used to hand out pledge cards, this and that. You say, our building's paid. Yeah, but the world is still waiting. We're going to take missions trips that are going to blow you away. I'm going to ask you, $25 a month, first fruits. We asked for 5,000. Is that right, Sister Vella? And 80% of the church, and you're shaking your head in the back, 80% of the church would respond to $5,000, 80%. 3% responded to 10,000. I'm asking everyone in this house, because of the blood, not because of the need, but because of the blood, I'm asking you every month, starting today, by the leading of the Holy Spirit, for missions, home missions, foreign missions, to fulfill the Great Commission. If it's $20 a month, listen, if a clown can have a gimmick on TV and make an appeal and you give, I think as a man of God, I can make an appeal for your life and for this world. So I'm asking for additional gifts, first fruits to activate the blood upon your life. Listen, you can't purchase the blood. You can't pay for it. But I'm asking you to activate your faith. $25 a month extra. $50 a month extra. Some of you $100 extra for missions to apply the blood to the foreign field. Now remember, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Remember, Leviticus 27:30 says the tithe is holy. Remember, Malachi 3 says it's holy. Hebrews 12:24, we just read to you. Or did we not? Hebrews 12:24, guys. To Jesus, the mediator. Jesus, the mediator. Now look at Romans 11:16. I was done preaching before. This is tithes and offerings. Look at Romans 11:16, and we're finished. For if the first fruit is holy, so is the lump. You could stop right there. If the first fruit is holy, so is also the lump. And if the root is holy, what instrument takes care of the root? The axe. Today, I spoke the way I have because an axe was in my hand. This is New Testament, New Covenant. The tithe is holy. So is the first fruit. You're not bargaining with me. You're not doing God a favor. You're not doing God a solid. The Bible says the first fruit is holy. But notice here, first fruit, Pastor Joe, is not capitalized. It means you're the first fruit. It means you're the first fruit. It means I'm the first fruit. Jesus originally was the first fruit of many brethren. Now watch this. And the lump. Sometimes we're just a lump of clay. And the Father's saying, can I mold you? Can I make you? Can I shape you? This has been the word of the Lord. Amen.